Today we are going to discuss some properties of BRST operators or BRST transformation. So if you recall, we use BRST transformation to prove that gauge theory is a denormalizer. Okay, namely that the gauge theory action after gauge fixing was not gauge invariant, but it was BRST invariant. And there we said that you just have to add all possible denormalizable terms or all possible terms of dimension less than or equal to 4, which are BRST invariant. And that gives a denormalizable theory. So today we are going to use BRST symmetry with in order to understand some more properties of gauge theories. But before I do that, let me remind you how the BRST transformation laws look. So I'll denote the BRST transformation by delta B. And now, in order to also distinguish between different parameters, I'll put a label zeta on top. Okay, this tells us that we are making a BRST transformation with the parameter zeta. Okay, this is a Grassmann parameter. So let me remind you that this acting on matter and gauge fields this was defined to be delta gauge transformation with theta A of x being given by zeta times c of x of the same fields matter and gauge. On the c ghost, this was given by minus half GF BCA theta CC of X. Okay, I am taking F to be totally anticipated by normalizing generators appropriately. And then finally, the BRST transformation law of the B ghost was given by minus 1 over alpha zeta AG of X. Well, this was the gauge fixing function. Now, if you look at these transformations, you will see that there is something unusual about this particular transformation in the following sense, that these transformations do not depend on the details of the action. They only depend on the gauge transformation. Okay? They do not depend on the details of the action, neither do these depend on the gauge fixing function, okay, HA. Right, because the matter transformation is determined by just a representation that the matter belongs to of the group. The transformation law of the gauge fields is determined by the structure constants, FABC. Same is true for this. Okay, the transformation law of this is determined by the gauge algebra, nothing else. But if you look at the transformation law of B, it depends on the details of the action, in particular on the details of the gauge fixing term that we have taken. So if you change the gauge fixing term, okay, of course the action will change because the gauge fixing term will change, but the transformation law B will also change. Now it turns out that this is not very convenient for manipulating BRST charge, BRST operator. So what we'll do first today is to try to repair this. Okay, try to rewrite the transformation laws in a way where the transformation laws are independent of the choice of gauge fixing term or the choice of the action. They should be only determined in terms of the gauge algebra and the representation matrix. Is this clear? So this is what we want to repair. Okay, that this depends on the gauge fixing function. Depends on AG. So the way we'll try to repair it is the following. So first we are going to introduce a new set of fields. So introduce a new set of fields. Okay, for every A, for every generator of a gauge group, we introduce chi A of X. And we replace the gauge fixing function by a new gauge fixing function, S tilde GF. Where S tilde GF is taken as follows. S tilde GF will be alpha over 2 integral d cos x chi A phi A plus integral d cos x is this clear? Right, we are just introducing a new set of fields and we forget about the old gauge fixing function. Instead we introduce these two terms. So the first thing we want to check is that this action is equivalent to the original gauge fixing action that we have introduced. So the way to do it is to rewrite this as S tilde by completing the square. So I'll write this as alpha over 2 integral d for x chi A plus 1 over alpha into times chi A plus 1 over alpha into minus 1 over 2 alpha integral d for x. Okay, because when you expand this out, okay, there is a chi A term which is here. There is a chi A H A cross term, two of them will cancel this, so 1 over 2. So that will give rise to this term. And then you have to subtract off the H A H A term. That's what you have done. So you recognize that this is our old gauge fixing term. Okay. As far as this is concerned, we can deal with this simply by changing variables. So in the action, for example, we had integral d chi. In the path integral, we had integral d chi, right? E to the I s times product over I y. So this, we have d chi as well as other fields. Let's call this d phi. Okay. So these were the original fields. Okay, this is a new field. The original fields include matter, ghost, gauge fields, everything. Okay, this was the original thing. Now we have a new set of fields, right? Because chi A we have introduced. But what you can do is that we just define chi tilde A as chi A plus 1 over alpha A G if the other, all the other fields unchanged, then this measure will become d chi tilde d phi. Is that clear? D chi d phi will become d chi tilde d phi.
If the gauge fixing term is linear in fields.
No linearity. For any gauge fixing term. The way it happens is that this transformation is upper triangular. If you look at a determinant, right? It's like you have two variables, x and y, right? You take x equal to x plus some function of y, right? But y goes to y. If you look at the Jacobian, you will find that the matrix is upper triangular, right? X depends on y, but y doesn't depend on x, right? So diagonal is just one, right? And x depends on y, so there is on the upper block, there is an entry. But if you have a matrix solved, all of its diagonals are 1, and there are some entries in the upper triangle, triangular block, the determinant is 1. Is this clear? So, let me write it here. So, this kind of change of variables is quite common, and we should keep this in mind that when you have, suppose you have two variables, x and y, right? X, say x tilde is equal to x plus some function, arbitrary function of y, right? Not necessarily linear. Y tilde equal to y. Okay? Here the role of x tilde and x are played by this chi tilde and chi. The role of y is played by all the other fields, right? Which you are not changing. Right? The matter field, host fields, gauge fields, they are not changing. So now you want to change variables from xy to x tilde y tilde, right? So what is the Jacobian? So the Jacobian will be determinant of del x tilde del x, del x tilde del y tilde del x, del y tilde del y. So this is the determinant of 1, del x tilde del y will be f prime of y, del y tilde del x is 0, and this is 1. Okay, so whenever you have a change of variable in which one set of fields is changing, the other ones are not changing, then the Jacobian is 1.
That
shape
will change in a particular
way,
I mean, x plus...
Yes, x by shift. So x tilde goes to x plus some shift, right, which can be a function of all the other variables.
No, not including x.
Not including x, exactly. Right, so then I'm just... This H doesn't include chi. Okay? So H depends on all the other fields, but not... Okay, so this is why this is the same. So d chi d phi becomes d chi tilde d phi. Okay. When we express the action in terms of chi tilde, you see that you just have a e to the I alpha chi tilde. So that part just factors out. Okay. And it will cancel in the numerator and denominator. Is this clear? Should I write it? What I am saying is that if we take integral d chi d phi d I is the product of I y sum of factors, this can be written as integral d chi tilde d phi, and the action is exponential I integral d 4x chi tilde A, chi tilde A, plus A sold, times product over I, y. Okay. So the chi tilde part can be factored out, so integral d chi tilde, which will be I integral d 4x, chi tilde A, times integral d phi, so when you calculate a correlation function by dividing it by similar integral without the y's, what is going to happen is that this part, because it factors out, will just cancel between numerator and denominator, okay, leaving us with the old correlation function. Okay, so this is what shows that if we calculate correlation function with this new theory, it is the same as a correlation function with the old theory. Okay, that S gauge fixing, you can replace by S tilde gauge fixing, because the extra term just drops out in the correlation.
These operators,
this should be independent of time, because these were the old operators. Right? So the old operators, of course, have no knowledge about time. Right? They are dependent. I mean, if you take gauge invariant operators, they are made up only matter and gauge fields. Even if you include the host fields, right? they can include matter and host fields and gauge fields. As long as they don't involve chi, there is no problem with the chi dependence of y, right? If this factors out.
So, can we think of this as
yes. Yeah, so what I'm saying is for this to work, you don't need to use the y's are gauge invariant. Okay? Even if the y's are not gauge invariant, okay, this is still true that instead of using the original gauge fixing term SGF, I can use S tilde GF with this a new extra set of fields. It will give exactly the same result, irrespective of whether the y's are gauge invariant or not. Okay? The only thing we need is that the y's are time independent. Okay? Because the y's are the original operators. Okay? It doesn't make sense to talk about y's in the original theory when chi's were not there. Okay? So when we're trying to show that the two sets of polarization functions are equal, you have to use the same y's. Okay? So y's cannot depend on chi. Okay, so you can just replace the original gauge fixing term by this. Okay, which is a sum of two terms. One is chi a chi a, the other one is a chi a h a. Okay, so let me write this again because we are going to make use of this. So S tilde GF, I also write S cos, is now integral d4x alpha by 2 pi to chi a plus integral d4x chi a ha minus integral d4x d4y dA of x delta H A theta X delta theta B Y C Y. Okay, so this is now our new gauge fixing term, the ghost term. Ghost term, of course, you are not changing. Right? The same action that we had. All we said was that the original gauge fixing term is equivalent to some of these two. So now, we'll try to write down the BRST symmetry of this new theory. Okay, this is of course equivalent to the original theory, so this better have a BRST symmetry. Okay. But now that we have introduced a new set of fields chi a, okay, we have to check what the transformation laws are. Okay. So the new BRST symmetry that we'll take, new BRST transformation laws, is delta B. I'm only writing down the ones that are different from the original one. So that minus 1 over alpha times HA, that was there for the transformation of BA, I replace by zeta times chi. Is this clear? Of course, we have to check that these leaves are actually invariant. Okay, so that's what we'll try to check now. And then we'll see why this is useful. So delta P zeta of S so where will it differ? It will differ in the fact that we have the gauge fixing term itself has changed, right? So you have to work out how it acts on this, and that here there is a B. Earlier, if you remember, the delta V A was minus 1 over alpha times H A times zeta. That has changed. Now, there is some zeta times chi A. So, you have to take that into account. The matter part, the gauge invariant part, of course, is still BRST invariant, right? Because the gauge invariant part depends on the matter and gauge fields. But then, we have not changed the BRST transformation now. Okay? They are still the same. So, delta V, let's look at the transformation of S tilde GF plus S tilde ghost. So first of all, this is easy. Chi A is invariant, so this doesn't change. Here, there will be change from H A. Chi A, of course, is invariant, but H A, of course, depends on all the matter fields, right? So here it will change. So H A, in fact, depends on the matter fields through matter and the gauge fields. So as far as HA is concerned, the BRST transformation law of HA is the same as the gauge transformation law with gauge parameter replaced by theta times zeta times C. Okay. So this will be given by integral d4x chi A and now I'll write d4y delta HA theta X delta theta B Y at theta equal to 0 times zeta C V of Y. Is this notation clear? So you are trying to find out the BRST transformation of HA, right? So which is the same as the gauge transformation of HA, okay? Infinitesimal gauge transformation. If you have an infinitesimal gauge transformation of HA, it would have been delta A delta theta B at theta equal to 0 times delta theta B, right? If you make an infinitesimal transformation of theta B. All I am doing is changing the theta B, replacing the theta B by zeta times CB. Okay, so this is the transformation law of this, of HA. And then we have to look at this one. So minus integral d4x d4y. We have to look at the BRST transformation of this, this and this. What about the BRST transformation of this? Delta BA is this, right? So zeta pi A of x. Delta H A theta of X delta theta Y theta C D of Y. Is okay or no? No, but don't see that. Just C D of Y. And then we have integral d4x d4y dA. Let me write here delta B zeta of this whole thing. you have to transform this whole, which means you have to transform this as well as you have to transform this. Now the first thing you notice is that these two terms cancel. Is that clear? Zeta, these are of course Gaussmann even. So zeta can be brought through to the left. Okay, so zeta chi a, then you have delta h a theta delta theta b as we have there, c b of y. Right. So the first term and the second term cancel. Is it okay? This term, this analysis of this term is the same as the original analysis, right? Because nothing has changed as far as the transformation of this is concerned and this is concerned, nothing has changed. Right? And if you remember in the original analysis, we had shown that this is zero. Right? Because there is transformation of this and then transformation of this, they cancel. So this is zero from the original analysis. From earlier analysis. Okay. And these two cancel. So we conclude that indeed the action is BRST invariant. If you take S tilde, sorry, this S ghost part hasn't changed, this same the S ghost. If you take the sum of this new gauge fixing term and the ghost action that we introduced, that is still BRST invariant. So the original BRST invariance in this new variables take this form. But as I said, in this new form, you can see that there is no dependence on the action on the right-hand side, right? Right-hand side doesn't depend on the gauge fixing term. There is no knowledge about HA in the transformation term. There is not even a knowledge about the gauge invariant action that we started with, right? It just is purely algebraic. And these are some utility that we'll see.
Questions? So this chi A can be any field.
Chi A is just a new set of fields. Can be any field meaning it's bosonic, it's Gaussmann even. Okay. It's just a new set of fields, right, that you are introducing, but they will the operators whose correlation functions you are interested in doesn't depend on the chi A's. So these are often called auxiliary fields, right? Because they don't have any regular kinetic term. As you can see, there's no del mu chi A, del mu chi A term, right? So this is the full action envelope chi A's. So they have been introduced for convenience, but they really have no special role to play. Is this okay? You just think of the action as if it has acquired a new set of fields, but no correlation function that will ever calculate will involve operators that depends on these fields. Okay, now I'll leave this as an exercise for you to check that if you take two BRST transformation laws, first one parameters by zeta 1, then parameters by zeta 2 on phi, this is 0 for any field. And because it is zero for any field, it also follows immediately where delta v zeta 1, delta v zeta 2 on any operator, any function of the fields is equal to 0. So let's first check that this implies this, then we will see how to prove this, right? So what is this? This will be delta B zeta 2 phi I delta F delta phi I. Functional derivative. I am not writing the arguments because it should in principle involve x and integrated over x and so on, right? But it's just look at it like this. Okay, imagine that the sum over I also includes integration over x. Now when you apply delta b zeta 1 on this, there will be two kinds of terms. When what delta b zeta 1 acts on this delta b zeta 2, that is 0 by this one, right? Because delta b zeta 1, delta b zeta 2 on any field we have said is 0. So the other term is where this delta v zeta 1 acts on this delta f delta phi I. So that will be delta v zeta 2 of phi I delta v zeta 1 of phi I times delta 2 f, sorry, this is phi j, okay, let's assume for now that the fields are bosonic, but it's also true for just one invariant fields. So it's the second derivative. And now if you just think about this a little bit, you will see that this quantity, this is symmetric under IJ. Okay. This one on the other hand is anti-symmetric under IJ. It's anti-symmetric simply because the zeta 1 and zeta 2, when they change their position, it picks up a minus sign. Okay. So you can easily convince yourself that this part is anti-symmetric under IJ exchange, and that's why this term is 0. Okay, you don't see it immediately, you just have to work out some examples, right? And then you will see that this implies this. Okay, in particular, that this is identically 0 by. Because this is symmetric, this is anti-symmetric. This is clear, but this is something you have to prove. Okay, this doesn't follow from anything as such. You have to actually look at the BRST transformation laws and check this is true or not. The fact that this kind of thing will vanish, okay, this just follows for any transformation which involves a Grassmann valued parameter. Okay, that this is symmetric and this will be anti-symmetric. Is this point clear or should I explain? Okay. See, what you have to think of is the following, right? We have this zeta 2 and zeta 1. Okay. Let's just pull them out. Okay, because this will be zeta 1, zeta 2 times something, this will be zeta 1 times something. Okay. Let's just pull all of them out. Then you will be left with some fi fj, right? Delta, this will be of the form zeta 2 times some fi, and this will be of the form zeta 1 times fj, right? Okay. Let's just pull zeta 1 and zeta 2 out. Okay. Then this is like fi fj, delta 2 f, delta phi I, delta phi j. Okay. I have taken the phi i's to be bosonic, right? Grassmann. So this is symmetric, but because the zetas are Grassmann odd, fi and fj must be Grassmann odd, right? Otherwise the transformation law doesn't make sense, right? If you are varying a Grassmann even field, this better be Grassmann even, this combination, but this is Grassmann odd, so fi must be Grassmann odd, similar, so must be fj. So fi fj will be minus fj fi, that's the simple argument. So for when phi I and phi are both Grassmann even, then it follows that if I and fj are Grassmann odd, and this vanishes. Okay. You can repeat this analysis by assuming that phi I is Grassmann even phi j is Grassmann odd, or phi I and phi j are both Grassmann odd, right? And every case you will find that whatever combination appears here exactly cancels this one. Okay, either this is symmetric, this is antisymmetric, or vice versa. Okay. So you will get zero at the end. So this I'll leave as an exercise. That let's call this B, let's call this A, that B follows from A. B follows from A. Which part?
The first part. The delta v is I1 and delta v is I2. So phi only has to be the ghost part because chi is already 0.
Chi is 0, but the point is the other fields, matter fields, they transform, right? Mm-hmm. Under BRST transformation. So you have to check for matter fields also. Yeah. It's in fact not trivial to check also for matter. Okay, because delta v, zeta y, zeta v is non trivial on matter. And on top of which you are acting at delta v zeta 1, so two gauge transformations, right? So it's not obvious that it works this way. Okay, I'll just indicate how it's proved, but I'll not go to the full analysis. Okay. So let's start from the easy one. Okay, delta v zeta 1, delta v zeta 2 on time. So how much is this?
Zero.
Zero. Right? Obviously zero transforms to zero. Right? So this is zero. Then let's take a little more difficult. Delta V zeta 1, delta V zeta 2 on BA. So delta V zeta 2 on BA is how much? Zeta 2 chi A, right? The chi A of zeta 2 of course doesn't transform, it's just a parameter, right? And delta B zeta 1 of chi A is how much?
Zero.
Right? So this is again zero. Is clear? Okay, now a little more difficult one, delta V zeta 1, delta V zeta 2 on CA. So CA here I have to remember the exact transformation. This is delta V zeta 1 of this I had given minus half G F B C A. So now you have to apply delta V zeta 1 on this, right? It transforms CC and CV, these two. Okay. Now you can easily convince yourself that they will give the same result. The reason is that this product is antisymmetric under CB exchange, right? It is antisymmetric under CB exchange, right? But this is also already antisymmetric, right? So if you just transform one, it will be automatically antisymmetrized because of this MPC, right? So you just put a factor of 2 and transform one of them. So let's do that. So this is minus half G F B C A zeta 2, and then we have minus half F, let's call this D E C, then C CD, right? CD, then CD. Okay, this CD just comes out. Where is G?
Twice.
Times two. And there's a zeta 1, right? Zeta 1, because this is in terms of zeta 1. The zeta 1 is the zeta 1 over here. So this gives you G square by 2, zeta 2, zeta 1, F E C A, F E E C, C E, C B, C B. Is this zero? Yes. Is zero? Sorry. Five? Yes, this is more than 2, but they are different. B, B, D, E, right? So you can certainly have different generators, right? SU2 itself has 3 generators. So this could have been 1, 2, 3, right? So it starts 0 that really.
But 2F will give the delta B, E and delta that thing will rise. So 2Fs.
Okay. So the point is that this, you see that this is totally anti-symmetric in B, D and E, right? Okay. Now, this is of course already anti-symmetric in D, okay? But you have to actually manifestly anti-symmetric in B, D and E, right? Because you can manifestly anti-symmetric in B, D and E, right? This one. So, this anti-symmetry in B, D and E, anti-symmetry in B, D, E. Okay. Basically, you can use to write this as a sum of 3 terms, okay? This plus cyclic permutation of B, D, and E. This is 0 by Jacobian. Right? That's the way you can show that this is 0. Right? So it's not trivially 0, unlike the first two, right? But it is 0. Is this clear? Okay, so let me just indicate how to do one more thing and then the rest you can do. So suppose you have a field psi in representation R, matter field. Ghosts we have all finished, right? B and C we finished, chi the extra field that we have introduced we finished. Suppose you have a psi in representation R and you want to calculate delta B zeta 1 delta B zeta 2 on psi. This one is going to give you minus IG RA P zeta CA times I. Right, I made infinitesimal transformation with gauge transformation parameter replaced by zeta CA. This is here. when the second one acts, okay, there are two terms. One is that when it acts on psi again, okay, that will give you RATA times RATB, okay, another RATB times zeta CB. The other term comes because this has to now also act on CA, okay, there is also a field. Transformation of CA you have to read out from here. And what you can check is that those two terms will cancel. Okay. Here you have a RATA, RATB, right? So two generators. Okay. The other term has only one factor of RATA, but there's an F. Okay. But you can see now, see why it should cancel, right? How it could cancel possibly, right? Because the term which has RATA, RATB, right, also has CACB, right? That's already anti-symmetric. So it becomes a commutator. Right, and then the commutator you have to re-express in terms of FABC RATC, right? And once you do that, you will find that the terms cancel. Is this clear? Right, so I will leave it as an exercise to check that this is zero. Okay. And finally, a little more difficult thing is delta B zeta 1, delta B zeta 2 on A mu, okay. This is also 0. Okay. This will be a little more difficult because there will be some few extra terms. Because A mu A has, there is an FABC term, there is also a del mu theta A term. Okay. So FABC term will have to use Jacobi. Okay. And for del mu theta A, we have to do some manipulations to show that they eventually cancel. So a net upshot of this is that delta B zeta 1, delta B zeta 2 on any field is 0, and hence acting on any operator it gives you 0. Okay, any operator made up all the fields. Now we'll see how to make use of this. So the first thing, okay, this is of course a straightforward consequence of the fact that it's a symmetry, but let me write it anyway. The fact that the BRST transformation is a symmetry of the action has the following consequence. It tells us that if we take a product over I, Y, and that calculate the delta B zeta of this, right? Which basically means what? That you calculate product over I, Y, the sum over J, product over I not equal to J, Y, times delta B O J. This correlation path is equal to 0. This is a statement of any symmetry. Right? If whenever there is a symmetry of the action, you just vary in a correlation function, each operator one in turn, this is the infinitesimal transformation. And the net change is 0. This is clear? Right? You prove it by writing down the path integral and making a change of variables, right? Making a change of variables that is induced by that particular transformation. And that change of variables leaves the action unchanged, right? Leaves the measure unchanged, right? And it varies all the operators infinitesimally, right? So one at a time. That's what this is telling us. So this is true for any symmetry. When you use BRST symmetry, these identities have names, okay, they are called word identities. Word identities, or sometimes also called sum of Taylor identities. So they basically give relationship between the various correlation functions. Because after all, what is delta v o j? This is again a linear combination of operators, right? Is delta v o j, okay, is some linear combination of operators. That's clear, right? It is very easy. So it gives a relationship between the different correlation functions, right? So that relation, of course, if you actually calculate each of those correlation functions, you will find that those that relation holds. Okay, so it's not that this is giving you something more than what you could have already calculated explicitly, right? But it is telling you that you can derive these identities without actually doing the calculation, right? Then if you do the calculation, these identities must hold, right? You will find that these relations must be holding.
Order doesn't matter.
Yes, the order matters. I have implicitly assumed that these y's are all Grassmann even, right? If some of these are Grassmann odd, then you have to derive some signs, right? Because otherwise, I have to put this as O1 to OJ minus 1, then this, and then OJ plus 1 to this thing, right? So, I have to say, let me write into some sign, right, that is needed for moving this OJ from in the product to this. So, are there questions on this? Is everybody agrees with this? Okay, now I'm going to give you some definition and then we'll justify why this definition is useful. So we'll define O will be called a physical operator. Called physical operator if delta B zeta O. All gauge invariant operators are physical, right? Because gauge invariant operators, of course, are BRST invariant. Not all physical operators may be gauge invariant, right? In fact, we will see that you can construct a lot of physical operators which are not original gauge invariant operators. So the goal here is that we will try to identify what are the possible physical operators and their correlation functions without referring to the original gauge symmetry, right? In fact, this is what you have been emphasizing, that once you have gauge fixed, right, you don't have a trace of the original gauge invariance, right? You still have BRST invariance. Can you identify, just using BRST invariance, okay, which operators are physical, which are not? Okay? Calculate their correlation functions, okay? Without having to refer back to the original gauge invariant action, right? Suppose somebody gave you an action which is BRST invariant, told you what the BRST transformation laws are. Could you have used that information to identify who should be the physical operators in this theory? Okay? That's the question. Okay. So what you are saying is that we like call an operator physical if it satisfies this. Now suppose take any operator. Okay? Take any operator, okay, not necessarily physical, and suppose you take delta v zeta of t. Okay, make a BRST transformation. So this has the general form of zeta times n is some other operator. If k was physical, l will be 0, right? But in general, it's zeta times n. Now, if you calculate delta b zeta prime of delta b zeta, okay, this of course is 0, you know, because if you apply the BRST operator twice, it gives you 0. But this is nothing but zeta times delta b zeta prime of L. Right? Because you are applying, this is zeta times L. So this implies that delta b zeta prime of L is equal to 0. Any parameter, right? It's arbitrary parameter. So this means what? This means L is physical, right? So L is physical. These operators are called trivial operators, okay, or BRST trivial. They are physical. Okay, but they are trivial in a sense that we will be describing soon, right? But this is just a name. So definition, L is BRST trivial. They are part of the O's, right? O is a big list of operators. In this list, there are some which are obtained like this, which are actually delta b zeta or something, right? Those operators we will call BRST trivial, right? So these are a subset of the physical operators.
Every non-physical operator variation is physical operator.
Is a physical operator, exactly.
But sir,
yes,
L is not a unique thing. It's, you can aggregate L any physical operator, but also satisfy this relation.
Yes. So, but that itself is a physical operator, right? So of course, if you add two physical operators, it's still physical.
Yeah, no, I am telling that in that way one cannot really fix what is unique.
You don't have to. I mean, any. Well, I agree. You cannot fix what. Well, you cannot fix what is L. L by definition is this. So this here, there's no ambiguity, right? You vary K, whatever you get, you call L. Right? And that L is BRST invariant, right? That's what you are, what you are saying. Okay. Now we'll see why these are trivial. Okay. So now we are going to prove an identity, okay, which is that if we take a correlation function, okay, which has some physical operators, okay, and some trivial operators, then the correlation function is identically zero. Okay. If it has even one trivial operator, okay, then the correlation function is zero. Is clear that so while trivial operators are physical, they are trivial because they are correlation functions with other physical operators are all zero. Okay, other physical operators may also include some trivial operators, right? Doesn't matter. Is this point clear? Okay, so let's try to prove this. In fact, with the identities that we have, it's just one line proof. So suppose P1 to Pn are physical, and then there's one which is called Pn plus 1 is trivial. That means what? That there is some, this means that there is some operator, there is some K, some operator K, operator K, such that delta V zeta of K is zeta times P plus 1. Okay, this K need not be unique. field, this is what I what this was saying, there are more than one k whose variation gives to pn plus 1, doesn't matter. Yeah. But if it's trivial, that means there is at least some k, okay, such that this is true. So our goal is to calculate a correlation function involving the p1 to pn and pn plus 1. Okay. But we will start from a slightly different correlation function. Okay. Let's start from p1 to pn and k. These are all physical, this is not. Okay. This is unphysical in general. But we know, of course, that this is 0. Okay. This is 0 for any operator, doesn't matter whether this is a physical or not physical. Because action is BRST invariant, so all correlation functions are BRST invariant. So this satisfies this. But now you have to vary each at a time, right? It's a sum of n plus 1 terms, right? Delta B zeta acts on each at in turn. So what will it give on these? 0, because pure is physical, right? Delta B zeta of this is 0. So the only term that will contribute is when it acts on this. Okay. So this is given by u1 to pn delta b zeta of k. But this is zeta times pn plus 1. Right? So this means, this implies p1 to pn, pn plus 1 is 0.
So every trivial operator is transforming
of something. Yes. That something need not be unique, right? Because if you add a trivial operator to something, its transformation law remains the same, right?
But if you have a trivial operator, then there will be some operator
whose transform is that trivial operator, exactly. Right? So the idea is that you start with a correlation function which involves the physical fields and then that operator, right? Then take delta of that, which is 0. Right? And delta acts only on the that something which is not physical, and produces a set of physical operators and a trivial operator. They are correlated. You know, that is 0. Because you start with 0, right? Because this is 0 is a consequence of BRST invariance of the action. Is this clear? So this has the following immediate consequence. Suppose you have a BRST operator. You add to it a trivial operator. Suppose, right? You get a new BRST, new physical operator. You have a you have a physical operator. You add a trivial operator, right? That's a new physical operator because trivial operators are also physical. These two physical operators have identical correlation functions to all other physical operators. Okay, take P. And P plus Q, where Q is trivial. Okay. P is physical, Q is also physical, but Q is trivial. Okay. So P and P plus Q with any other physical operators give identical results. Because Q with other physical operators give you 0, right? So you can always replace P by P plus Q without changing the correlation functions. Okay. So this allows us to define what is called an equivalence relation. Okay. We call P and P plus Q equivalent, okay, because their correlation functions are all the same. So, given physical operator Q, P, operator P and a trivial operator Q, and p plus q are considered invariant. There are many q's, yes. So any q you take, you add to p, that's supposed to be an equivalent operator.
There is some constraint that q have to handle at the boundary, means like the small gauge transformers in the string.
Well, these are all we are working on developing infinitesimal transformations, right? So there is a large gauge transformation in this, right? So you are really looking at local operator.
So q will also. So we will consider those q's which actually are vanishing at the...
Yeah, these are, I mean, you are just thinking of the local operator side right now, right? Or at least integrated over a certain region. So real physical observables in a gauge theory are these equivalence classes, right? There are many physical operators, but many of them are actually not relevant because they just give zero correlation. So you want to classify what are the possible physical operators, right? You classify physical operators only up to these equivalences, right? Which is called equivalence classes of physical operators, right? And this also has a name, which is called BRST cohomology, right? But you don't really need to know the name. It just, it's enough to know that is the equivalence classes of physical operators, which you should really think of as physical observables in gauge theory. Yes, but every gauge invariant object is physical,
yes.
But not all physical operators need to be gauge invariant, because some, there may be physical operators made of the hosts, right? I mean, if you take QB, say delta Q, xi on anything, it is physical, right? So that's why in the BRST formalism, right, you don't go back to the original gauge symmetry, right? Because gauge symmetry is not a symmetry anyway. For the gauge fixed action, right? You always think in terms of BRST transformation, which operators are BRST invariant, which are not. Right? But the point is, if we try to classify operators just based on their BRST invariance, you get too many operators, right? Many operators which are not there in the original gauge theory also become part of BRST invariant spectrum, right? But then you realize that most of those operators have actually zero correlation function with everything else, right? So that's why you define the equivalence classes, right? And typically the equivalence classes, they are one-to-one correspondence with the original gauge invariant operators. Okay? Sometimes there may be exceptions, but mostly it is true. That, so what you can show is that given any BRST invariant operator, right, generically you can add to it some trivial operator to make it the same as the original gauge invariant operators. Okay, but there are exceptions to this. That if you just classify operators by demanding that they are BRST invariant, right, you will get too many operators. Many of the operators which are not there in the original gauge invariant. Okay? But most of them go away once you impose this equivalence relation. Right? You can choose to pick the equivalence class in terms of an operator which is not the original gauge invariant operator. Okay? But the most equivalence classes, okay, have one representative typically, which is the original gauge invariant operator. You add to it some ghost fields and you get other BRST invariant operators.
Is this?
Yeah. And any other questions?
What are the examples of these exceptions?
Well, the exceptions are sometimes in space, for spatial values of momentum, for example. You can get things made of ghosts, which are not necessarily equivalent to some gauge invariant operator, right? I mean, string theory, for example, one finds examples of this, but they are very esoteric, right? I mean, at a generic value of momentum, it doesn't happen. Okay, if you work in terms of Fourier transform modes, okay, sometimes in the Fourier transform space, the zero momentum modes have such examples. So those in the position space language, they are the analog of the integrated operator. Right? Sometimes you may get some integrated operator which do not fall in this class. Okay, so now I am going to discuss an application of this BRST invariance. Okay. And the application is the following. So, if you remember that we started with an original gauge invariant action, then we went to the Fourier procedure, okay, we gauge fixed, and then we arrived at the gauge fixed action. But suppose somebody has given us a gauge fixed action, right? We don't know that it came from Fourier power gauge fixing was original action, right? Can we prove that the correlation functions of the physical operators is independent of the choice of gauge? Okay? As far as the gauge fixed action is concerned, okay, if you change the choice of gauge, you are changing the action, right? If you change the action, all the correlation functions are supposed to change, right? That's what the action is supposed to do, right? You change it, you change all the correlation functions. But somehow, from the original gauge invariant theory perspective, the correlation function of the gauge invariant operator shouldn't depend on the choice of gauge, right? We want to prove it directly in terms of the gauge fixed action, right? We don't want to invoke the path integral, the Fourier Popov, and go back to the original action. We want to see, can we prove this independence of a choice of gauge by working in the gauge fixed theory? We'll use BRST invariance. Yeah, we'll see how we use it. Okay. So what is the strategy? What we'll show is that if we change, make an infinitesimal change in the gauge transformation data, right? What are the data for gauge transformation? The alpha, you can change alpha to alpha plus epsilon, right? Or you can change the function HA to HA plus something. So what we will show is that if we change, make any of these changes, okay, the action changes by something, right? It's integral of some operator. That operator is BRST trivial. Okay. Now, why does it help? Imagine that we have e to the is, right? Okay. E to the is gets changed to e to the is plus I epsilon times some k integral k. So the first order in epsilon, right, the way we will look at this change, if we have integral product over y into the is, this changes to integral product over I y e to the I s times 1 plus I epsilon integral k. Here I am just expanding out this e to the I epsilon integral k to the power series. So this is integral product over I y plus integral product over I y times integral k to the I s. These are a path integral. Maybe I should have written it. This is d phi. Okay. Path integral over everything. Clear what I have done here, right? What I am saying is here, the original correlation function involved calculating a path integral, right? I change S by a small amount, right? I bring that small amount in the down by expanding. So this I write as an original path integral and another path integral with product over I y multiplied by integral k. Okay, so this means that the correlation function, original correlation function, when you change gauge, changes to the original correlation function, plus a new correlation function, here you have integral k brought down. Epsilon has nothing to do with the I epsilon prescription, right? This is the epsilon of small change, whatever the small change is, right? Is clear? So now, if y is your physical, we want to show that the this doesn't change, right? If we can show that this is BRST trivial, then you are done, right? Because physical will be as trivial gives you zero correlation function. Right? So if you can show that under the change of gauge, the action changes by BRST trivial term, then that automatically shows that the correlation function of the physical operators do not change. Is that clear? Okay, so this is what you need to show. That when you make a change of gauge, the action changes by BRST trivial term. Well, this change is not delta V. You are just changing a gauge, say, direct alpha to alpha plus delta, alpha plus epsilon, right? Action changes by something. Yes. You have to now find a K, yes. K tilde, right? Such that the change of that K tilde is what the action has changed by. Not by delta V, but by this alpha goes to alpha plus epsilon. Right? So if we can show that, If this k, see this k right now has nothing to do with BRST, right? K came because that you have changed the gauge fixing parameter, either H or alpha, the action has changed, right? So we arrive at this relation without any assumption about if the y's are physical, if k is BRST trivial, nothing, right? It's just if action changes by S plus k, the correlation function changes by this, right? Now we focus on BRST invariant operator. Why is a BRST invariant, right? Because we want to check if the correlation function of BRST invariant operators remains unchanged under a change of gauge, right? If we focus on BRST invariant operators, then we still want to show that this is zero. Okay? Why want to show that this is zero is to show that K is BRST trivial. Okay? Because if K is BRST trivial, we have already shown that this correlation function vanishes. So what we need to do is to calculate k for these changes and check if it's BRST trivial or not. Okay. So let me do this, maybe it will become a little clearer. So let's say, suppose we take alpha to alpha plus epsilon. So let's check how much S changes. S goes to S plus what? There is S. The full action is written there, right? It's just this one. Alpha is the only, this is the only place where alpha is, right? So it goes to epsilon by 2 integral d4x chi a chi. Epsilon by 2 integral d4x. So what will you look for now? We look for an operator whose BRST variation is proportional to chi a chi a. Right? If we can show that, if we can find such an operator, then this will be BRST trivial. And our job is that. Is there such an operator whose BRST variation is chi a chi a? Yes?
BA times
chi a. Because delta BA is chi a, right? Delta d zeta of integral dA of x chi a of x is zeta times integral chi a chi a. Okay, so that's it. I mean, that shows that this operator is BRST trivial. Okay, and hence this change is 0. Yes. Other one I still have to show. Changing HA. Right? Principle is the same. You have to change HA by HA plus epsilon times FA and find a look for an operator, right? Whose BRST variation gives you that change.
So we have different HAs, different base fixing terms.
Yes. We'll make an arbitrary change. We'll see how it's done. Right? It's a little more complicated, but it's done in one go. Right? You don't have to. I mean, you can change from Lorentz gauge to any other gauge, right? Infinitesimally, of course, right? That if you want to change, for example, from Lorentz gauge to another gauge, you can change the coefficient of del mu mu by a small amount and increase the coefficient of the other one by a small amount, right? You can build all this infinitesimally. So as long as you can show that under infinitesimal change, the correlation function doesn't change, that's good enough. Right? So you'll always want the infinitesimal changes. So is this clear? So alpha independence is follows from here, right? Okay, so now the harder aspect. We want to change HA. Okay, so you have to change HA to HA plus epsilon times a small h. So any function of gauge fields and magnet fields. Okay, we want to make an arbitrary change in the gauge fields. So how much does S change? Plus some, right? So let's look at where HA appears in that and see how much it changes. So there is a chi a HA term. So HA changes by epsilon times F, right? So epsilon times integral d4x chi a HA. Small h, right? Where else does it change? In the ghost part. Here. So plus or minus integral d4x d4y dA of x to the next one here. Delta HA theta of X delta theta B of Y CD of X. Right, when you change capital HA to capital HA plus epsilon times small HA, the change in this is just epsilon times small HA, right? Because it's just adding. So now we have it. We have to look for a function whose variation is this. What is that function? So you want delta B zeta of something, or function. Equal to zeta times this. So make a guess, then we'll check if this is true or not. What is that something?
VH,
that looks like a possibility because delta B is sky here, right? So let's see if that's true or not. Okay. So delta B beta of integral d4x dh does it have a chance of being true or not?
Yes.
Delta B BA gives you pi, right? We have to calculate delta B H. What is that? Delta B H is a gauge transformation by zeta times CA, right? So that's exactly this. Right? A gauge transformation zeta times CB. But it's a minus sign. What happens to the minus sign? Yeah. So the point is zeta actually acts appears here, right? It has to be pulled through B, right? Because zeta is supposed to be zeta times that, right? So by the time you have pulled it through B, you get an extra minus sign. Right? So this is indeed exactly equal to this. Okay, so that shows that the variation of a gauge fixing function is also BRST trivial. Okay, it can be thought of as a trivial operator, and hence its correlation function with all the physical operators is zero. So the correlation function of the physical operators will not change when you make a change of this kind in that. Okay, so this way you can prove the gauge independence of correlation function of physical operators without having to refer to the original gauge fixing and Kolyapov procedure, right? Based on the path integral. Okay, this is the proof just purely based within this formalism. So within this gauge fixed action. Is this clear? So I think I'll stop here. We'll continue. So tomorrow and day after will be somewhat different topics. Okay. Because so far the way we have developed it, it's suitable for S matrix calculation. Right? You have you know how to calculate Dean's function, you can extract use LSD to calculate S matrix. Right? But tomorrow we'll see how quantum field theories can be also applied for low energy processes like atomic physics. Right? Suppose you want to calculate corrections to atomic physics results using quantum field theory. Then in fact it's important because some of the the precision tests of quantum field theory came from atomic physics, right? Not from high energy scattering. Okay, so we'll see how we can apply quantum field theory techniques to extract atomic physics results. Okay, or the corrections to atomic physics.